Welcome to the viewers for the lecture in the subject structural analysis. Actually, we have been discussing about strain energy method. Some more problems are yet to be done, including trusses. But still, I want to just introduce the matrix methods of structural analysis, which will be very useful for the online examinations, gate examination, other competitive examinations, and also for interviews. So this will be useful for many in the society. Therefore, I'll just introduce the method. I'll just give you an overview of the matrix methods, and then we will continue the rest of the topics. Right. Now, we have classical methods and also matrix methods. Now, classical methods have got some limitations, because suppose if you want to analyze a problem by slope deflection method, if the unknowns are 2, you will be comfortable to solve the problem. Even if it is 3, no problem. But when it is 4, 5 and so on, we will not be able to solve the simultaneous equations for getting the unknowns. Manually, we will not be able to do it. Similarly, every method, every classical method has got some limitations. But nowadays, we have to deal with multi-storied analysis of multi-storied, multi-bay buildings. Therefore, classical methods, we can use it for examination purpose and we can learn the basics, but that will not be useful for the analysis of multi-storied complex structures. Therefore, after the advent of computers, matrix methods have become popular. Matrix flexibility method, matrix stiffness method, and also finite element method. Matrix flexibility method, matrix stiffness method, and of course finite element method. And so many softwares have been developed after the advent of computers. But any data, if you feed, that will give some result. If you give right data, you will get the right results. If you give wrong data, then also you will get results, but they will be wrong. Therefore, one must be familiar with the procedure that is followed in the software. Therefore, you must have a basic idea about matrix flexibility method, stiffness method, and finite element method, so that you will be able to give the data appropriately. How it works, you have to understand. So, for small problems, we can, suppose the software is available, for small problems, we can try to apply the software. For known problems, you can check up the values, and then confidently use the software. Right. Now, we are going to discuss only matrix flexibility method and the matrix stiffness method. This will not be discussing in the lecture. So these methods are, because once if we take a software, whatever may be the size of the matrix, sometimes we will have to deal with some 800 by 800 equations, 800 equations, 900, 1000. Depending upon the size of the building, depending upon the number of variables. So, it may be any value. But after the latest development in the computer and also the software, in no time that will be able to solve. In no time. Just to give the data, come out, it will give you the results. That is possible. But how it works, we must know. So, that is the idea of this introduction or overview of the topic on matrix methods of structural analysis. Right. So, we will we will not be discussing this method. We will not be taking up this method. Right? Forget about this. Now, in these methods, there are two approaches. One approach is element approach. Element approach or transformation matrix approach. Second one is system approach. Or direct approach. So these are the two approaches. Now, so far, actually, this method was in existence. But actually, the methods have become popular only after the advent of computers. So matrix flexibility and matrix stiffness, they are meant for computers, used by computers. But this method is suitable for computer programming. For computer programming and also the real use of computer will be by element approach or transformation matrix approach. So only in some other places, only recently this method has been, this is there, but this has been introduced. But this second approach, namely system approach or direct approach, is not comfortable for computer programming. So you can do small problems, you can understand small problems, and also you will know what the different steps are doing, that you can do. But this is recently adopted, the direct approach, namely direct flexibility method and direct stiffness method, has been recently introduced in some other places. It was there, but in the syllabus it has been recently introduced. But only this is the method meant for the purpose for which the method has been developed. The purpose, the method, methods have been developed only for use by computers. So for that, only element approach or transformation matrix approach is suitable. But in these methods, namely element approach or transformation matrix approach, as far as I am concerned, I already given lectures, lecture number 1 to approximately 20, first 20 lectures. Say few will be on matrix flexibility method, and a second part will be on matrix stiffness method. So matrix flexibility method, matrix stiffness by element approach or transformation matrix approach has been already delivered by me in 1 to approximately 20, lecture number 1 to around 10, matrix flexibility method, and 11 to 20. So the purpose of this lecture is to introduce direct approach. This is what is there in the current syllabus. Right. Now, and here in the matrix methods, we are going to deal with generalized forces and generalized displacements. Before going to the particular method, we are going to deal with generalized forces or force vector. Generalized forces or force vector. Similarly, we are going to deal with generalized displacements. Or generalized displacement vector. Now here, suppose you take a vector of forces F1, F2, F3, F4, like this. Now we are going to mark, suppose if you take a cantilever. Now, suppose there is an axial force 1, there is a transverse force 2. Now, here there is a force 3, and here there is a moment 4. Now, all these are represented in the vector, force vector. So, F1 is an axial force. This is an axial force. F2 is a transverse force. F3 is a transverse force. And F4 is a moment. Therefore, in the generalized force vector, so depending upon the coordinate that we allot, so there is another term called coordinate. Coordinates. Or locations and directions in which we may apply a force, measure the displacement, or apply a known displacement, measure the corresponding force. They are called coordinates. Now, here, 1 is a coordinate, 2 is a coordinate. That is, along 2, we may be interested in applying a vertical force. Find out the corresponding vertical displacement, or we may apply a known displacement in the vertical direction, find out what is the force causing the deformation. So forces and displacements are the two important quantities that we are going to deal with. We may apply a force, measure the displacement caused by the force, or apply a known displacement, find out what is the force causing the deformation. One is in the flexibility method, the other one is in the stiffness method. That we will discuss later, Now, we are concentrating only on generalized force vector. Therefore, F1, F2, F3, F4, F5, F6 may be a combination of axial force, transverse force, bending moment, and also twisting moment. Twisting moment or axial twist, anything. Maybe a force or a deformation. So it, but only we know, depending upon the coordinate that we allot, we can find out which is the axial force, which is the transverse force, which is the moment. That contains everything, that's all. So computer will not know these things. Only we know which is the axial force, which is the transverse force. That is what is called generalized forces. Next is that of generalized displacements. Generalized displacement vector U1, U2, U3, U4. So this again, coming to this problem, this is U1 is the axial displacement because we have taken the coordinate along the axis of the member. U2 is the transverse displacement. Transverse, this is U2. And here, this is U3. U3 is the transverse displacement. Now here, if you want to find out the slope, this slope is U4. U4 is the rotational displacement. This is theta. This is delta. This is delta. This is axial deformation. This is axial deformation. This is rotation. Right, like that. Therefore, the generalized displacement vector will be consisting of axial displacement, transverse displacement, rotation, twist, angle of twist, etc. So we have to find out from the displacement vector, we have to take the required quantity because we know the coordinates that we allot. Therefore, that is about the generalized forces and generalized displacements, and also about the coordinates. Coordinates are simply locations. Suppose if you take a beam, if you mark a coordinate like this, so along one, you want to apply the force and to find out the displacement here, or apply a known displacement here and find out what is the force causing the deformation. Similarly, coordinate 2. So, we can add any number of coordinates, we can delete any number of coordinates depending upon our interest. What quantity we want to measure, where we want to measure. So, that is about the coordinates. Because these fundamental definitions are very essential for knowing the methods. So this is general about the methods. Now we will go to the method in specific. We will start with the matrix flexibility method. I told you that there are two methods. One is the element approach or transformation matrix approach, on which already lectures have been delivered. It is already there in the channel. Lecture 1 to 20 or so. Right. Now, we are going to follow the direct approach. First, we will start with the direct flexibility method. Direct flexibility method. Direct flexibility method. Or you can say system approach. We can say it is system approach. Earlier one was element approach. Now this is system approach. Anyway, I'll just mention the name of the next method also. Next method will be direct stiffness method. Stiffness method. Or this is also system different, stiffness matrix. System stiffness approach. Right. Now, these are the two methods. Right. Now, we will come to this method later. We will just introduce only the first method. This we will introduce later. Now, the flexibility method. Flexibility method is otherwise called as the alternate names for the method: force method, or compatibility method. Force method or compatibility method. Right. So these are the other names for the flexibility method. Now, why it is called force method? Force method because the primary unknowns, are the forces. The primary unknowns are the forces, therefore it is called force method. Also we are going to make use of principle of superposition of forces. So for these two reasons, it is called force method. Right. What is meant by principle of superposition? We have got a principle of superposition of forces as well as principle of superposition of displacements. When the structure is elastic, linear, linearly elastic, we can apply both principle of superposition of forces as well as principle of superposition of displacements. Now, for example, if we take a cantilever, we want to analyze the stress by matrix flexibility method. Now, there are number of forces. There is a force here, there is a moment here, there is a force here, moment here. You want to analyze the truss. You want to analyze the cantilever. Now, there are four forces. There are four coordinates. There are four forces. Four forces. Now, suppose if you get the deflected shape due to all these forces like this. Like this. So, this is say 1, 2, 3, 4. Right. This is, let us call this as U1. And corresponding to 2, it is a rotation. Therefore, with respect to horizontal, you draw a tangent. This is U2. And corresponding to this 3, this is U3. And the rotation here, when you draw a tangent, the rotation here is U4. So, this is due to the application of the force along coordinate 1, 2, 3 and 4. Now, according to principle of superposition of forces, what you can do is, you can consider this cantilever, apply the force along coordinate 1 only, find out the deflection. Of course, for clarity, I just drawn more or less the same value. Anyway, that is only for understanding. We call this as A11. Of course, we are yet to discuss the meaning for the term flexibility coefficient. Let us forget about flexibility coefficient. Let us say this is the displacement. Here we have used U, or we can say it is delta 11. Delta 1 means the deflection at coordinate 1 due to unit force at coordinate 1. Now here the rotation here, this is the displacement along coordinate 2 due to unit force at 1. Now here at this point, this is the displacement at coordinate 3 due to unit force at 1. Now here this rotation, this is the displacement along coordinate 4 due to unit force at 1. Second, let us apply same cantilever. We will apply unit force only along coordinate 2. That will also give you a deflected shape. You know, when you apply a moment at the free end, you calculate the slope and the deflection in the classical method. So, this is the deflection delta at coordinate 1. Coordinate 1 is this direction, coordinate 1, due to unit force along coordinate 2. Similarly, here this is the displacement along coordinate 2 due to unit force at 2. And here there is no force, but still it deflect. This is the displacement along coordinate 3 due to unit force at coordinate 2. Here this is the displacement at coordinate 4 due to the force along coordinate 2. So, in all the cases, we have applied unit force or force only along coordinate 2, and we have got the displacement along coordinate 1, 2, 3 and 4. Similarly, we can apply along the other coordinates also. That is, next one, let us apply unit for force along coordinate 3 only. Along coordinate 3 only. 3 only. There also you will get some deflected shape. So just for clarity, I am drawing all values of the same size. So if I draw a small depth, you may not be able to understand, so that you can just write. Now here also you will have deflection. Even when you apply a force here, there will be deflection. This is the displacement along coordinate 1 due to the force along coordinate 3. Here the displacement along coordinate 2 due to the force at coordinate 3. And here also deflection at coordinate 3 due to unit force at 3. And here this is displacement at coordinate 4 due to unit force at coordinate 3. Similarly, one more. I think that will be more than sufficient. According to the principle of superposition of forces, instead of applying all the forces at a time, since the principle of superposition of forces is applicable to linear elastic structures, we apply the forces individually, 1, 2, 3, 4, etc. Find out the displacements. Now, according to the principle of superposition of forces, U1 equal to delta 1, 1 plus delta 1, 2, delta 1, 1 plus delta 1, 2 plus delta 1, 3 plus delta 1, 4. You can apply the forces individually, add all the displacements along coordinate 1, that will give you the value of U1. That is what is called the principle of superposition of forces. So individual forces can be applied one at a time, and you can add all the displacements. Similarly, U2 equal to delta 1, 2 plus delta 2, 2 plus delta 3, 2 plus delta 4, 2. Delta 1, 1, 1, 2. Delta, so the displacement is delta 2, 1. This is, that is the displacement along coordinate 2 due to the force at 1, displacements along 2 due to force at 2, displacement along coordinate 2 due to force at 3, displacement along coordinate 2 due to the force at 4. All these things can be added, you will get U2. Like that, you can get the value of U1, U2, U3 and U4. So that is what is called principle of superposition of forces. So here, in the later, we will discuss the method. When we do problems on flexibility matrix method, we will be applying the redundant forces one at a time. And finding out the displacements. Finally, we are going to add everything. So that is applicable in this method. Therefore, this method is called force method. One is primary unknowns are forces. The other one is principle of superposition of forces can be applied. The other one is that of the compatibility method. The next name for the method is called the compatibility method. So these diagrams will be useful later also. Anyway, just without the diagram, I will explain there. Now we are going to make use of the compatibility equation. Compatibility of displacements. Compatibility equation. Compatibility. So this is what you are going to use in the matrix flexibility method. So the value is A into F equal to U. A into F equal to U. A into F equal to U. That is the compatibility equation. Compatibility of displacements. Now this is the flexibility matrix. A is the flexibility matrix. F is the force vector. U is the displacement vector. So this is the compatibility equation. Now these are the primary unknowns. These are the primary unknowns. That is why this method is called, since forces are treated as the primary unknowns, the method is called force method. Primary unknowns. Primary unknowns. Right. So for getting the value, A means F equal to. F equal to, these are the unknowns. F equal to A inverse into U. Of course, minus is there. Minus A into A inverse into U. So this is the equation, right? Now, whatever may be the problem that we solve. We may be interested in analyzing a continuous beam, a portal frame, a rigid, pin jointed truss, a statically determinate pin jointed truss, anything. Finally, we are going to deal with only this equation. All problems, we are going to deal with this equation. Number one, first of all, you have to become confident with the terms. What is our objective? What we are going to do? That we have to be very confident. Method is easy, but confusion about the terms and other things, that you have to avoid. So we know what is a force vector, you know what is a displacement vector already. Generalized force vector, generalized displacement vector already we have discussed. Now, what is this A? A is the flexibility matrix consisting of flexibility coefficients A11, A12 up to A1n, A21, A22 up to A2n, up to this AN1, N2, ANN. This is the flexibility matrix. Flexibility matrix. Right. You take any term. Any term you can take. This we call it as Aij. Aij. Aij is the flexibility coefficient. So the flexibility matrix will be an orderly arranged flexibility coefficients. Flexibility. So your flexibility coefficient is flexibility coefficient will be defined as the displacement at coordinate I, Aij AIJ stands for the displacement at coordinate I unit force at J, unit force. So that is, so these, all these values will be of displacements only. Just now we have explained one cantilever problem. So in a cantilever problem, what we have done is, we have applied the unit force along one only. This is a deflected shape. This we have called it as delta 1-1, displacement along coordinate 1. So suppose the force applied here is unity, that is why unit force at coordinate J, unit force at coordinate J, delta. So it is a displacement. When the force is unity, this one is A11. A11 is a displacement along coordinate 1 due to unit force at 1. Similarly, now this value is a displacement along coordinate 2 due to unit force at coordinate 1. Previously, we used delta 11, delta 21, etc. Same thing. So here it is the displacement at coordinate 3 due to unit force at coordinate 1. The force is unity here. The force equal to unity here. And the rotation here is the displacement along coordinate 4 due to unit force at coordinate 1. So this A11, A21, A31 and A41 will form the first column of the flexibility matrix. So the second suffix stands where the unit force is applied. Then the displacement along coordinate 1, 2, 3, 4, etc. So that will form the first column of the flexibility matrix. So flexibility coefficient is defined here. It is a displacement to coordinate I due to unit force at coordinate J. But when you apply unit force along coordinate 1 only, you will have the displacement. When you apply unit force along coordinate 1 only, you will have displacement here, displacement here, displacement here, and also displacement here. All points you will have displacements. So that will form the first column of the flexibility matrix. So what I want to stress here is all these values are only displacements. So here you have to remember very strongly, so they are all displacement coefficients. For forming the flexibility matrix, you have to apply the unit force, because forces are unknowns. In this equation, forces are unknowns. We do not know. So in the place wherever you have unknown forces, you apply a force equal to unity. F1 equal to unity, F2 equal to unity, F3 equal to unity, and form the displacement matrix. Form the displacement matrix. That is the left hand side column. So for getting the left hand side part of the compatibility equation, you have to apply unit force along all the given coordinates or along all the redundants, assuming the value of redundant equal to unity, and form the coefficients. They are all only displacements. So the term displacement is very important. Right. So that is one. Other one is that of the value of U. U is a displacement due to the given external forces. These are redundant forces. These are redundant forces. These are due to the given external forces. So this is the equation. So that is about the term flexibility coefficient, flexibility matrix, etc. So all the values on the left hand side consists of displacements. All the values on the right hand side also consists of displacements. So for getting the flexibility matrix, we have to find out the displacement due to the unit redundant force. For getting the right hand side column, we have to get the displacement due to the given external forces. External force. All only calculation of displacements. Displacement. So for calculating displacements, we can use any method that is known. We can make use of conjugate V method. Can go for conjugate B method, you can go for unit load method, you can go for moment area method. Or you can go for product integral table, product integral table or product integral chart or any method, because now we are very confident that all these values consist of displacements, all these values are consisting of displacements, and the redundant forces F are unknowns. Left hand side, right hand side, for all the terms you are going to calculate only the displacements. That has to be very strong. So for getting the displacement, you can use any of the methods based on the problem. Suppose if a particular problem, moment area method is convenient, we can go for moment area method. We want A11, A12, etc. They are all displacements. We can go for conjugate beam or unit load method, because for certain problems area moment method will be convenient, for certain problems conjugate beam method will be convenient, for certain problems unit load method will be convenient. Any method you can use, right? So that's about then coming to the size of the flexibility matrix. The matrix A, suppose if it is a statically determinate structure, the size of this matrix will be for determinate structures, statically determinate structures, that depends upon the number of coordinates. So, for a beam, say for a simply support beam, we may take only one coordinate. Therefore, the size of the matrix will be 1 by 1. We may take two coordinates, 1 and 2. The size of the flexibility matrix will be 2 by 2. 2 by 2, all the values will be only displacements. How to find out the displacement is our job. We have to just find out. Right. We may be interested in getting, say, along coordinate 3, coordinate 4 also. There are 4 coordinates. So these are the points of our interest. We are interested in getting the displacement here, applying a force. Or we may apply a displacement. What is the force causing the deformation? So that is our objective. So the coordinate, that depends upon our choice. As far as a statically determinate structure is concerned, it is based on the number of coordinates that we fix. So coming to indeterminate structures, so it depends upon the static indeterminacy. Depends upon the degree of static indeterminacy. Because indeterminate structures, first we have to find out the degree of indeterminacy. That will decide. Suppose if SI equal to 3, if SI SI equal to 3, then the size of the matrix will be 3 by 3. The size of the matrix will be decided by the degree of static indeterminacy in the case of statically determinate structures. Right, so that so we have discussed flexibility coefficient, flexibility matrix, and also the size of the flexibility matrix. Then, coming to indeterminate structures, the redundance we can choose. There are so many ways of making a structure statically determinate. For example, suppose we want to analyze a continuous beam, a two-span continuous beam, subjected to some system of loading, say UDL, this thing like this. Now, first of all, we have to find out the degree of static indeterminacy, and for this structure, the static indeterminacy equal to 2. That we will not consider it here, already we know, therefore equal to 2. So we have to, in the matrix flexibility method, the first work is finding out the degree of static indeterminacy and getting the primary structure, getting the primary the primary structure is the statically determinate structure. So if the degree of indeterminacy is 3, remove any 3 redundants, and make the structure statically determinate. That is what is called a primary structure. Primary structure is a statically determinate structure. And for a problem, there are number of ways of making the structure statically determinate. For example, in this is the given structure. This is the given structure. The primary structure, we can just get the primary structure like this. That is UDL and point load. So this is it's a cantilever. We have removed the support at this is A, B, C. So we have removed the support at B and the support at C. Now it becomes a cantilever. It is a statically determinate structure or primary structure. Now we have removed the support at B. So this is a redundant one. This is support at C. This is redundant two. R1 and R2 are the redundants. Now in this case, the redundants are the reactions. The corresponding displacements will be the vertical displacement. For calculating the vertical displacement, we have to use the moment area theory, area moment method, or any method we can use, any method. So the thing is, we have to remember, corresponding to this force, the displacements are the vertical displacement, that we have to remember. So redundants are the reactions, R1 and R2. So remove the redundants at B and at C and apply R1 and R2 as redundants. So first we will be calculating the displacement due to the given load. The displacement due to the given load at coordinate 1 and coordinate 2. This is coordinate 1, this is coordinate 2, will be U1, U2. That is due to the external force. We can use conjugate B method or any method for getting the displacement due to the external force. Then apply R1 alone equal to unity. You get the value of A11, displacements A11 and A21. Apply unit value of the redundant. Then forget about this. Apply unit value of R2. and get the second column, namely A21, A22, A22. That's all. So this will be the redundant, say F1 naught, let us call this F2 naught, or you can say R1 R2 itself, nothing wrong, R1 R2 itself. Therefore, we can get F1 naught, F2 naught equal to A11, A12, A21, A22 inverse into U1, U2, or U1F, U2F notation, no problem. So these values are readily available for us now. So we must be able to calculate due to the redundant forces applying one at a time. This is due to the external forces. When these values are ready, we can get the redundant forces. Once redundant forces are known, we can draw the bending moment diagram. So that is, so first we have to get the primary structure or statically determinate structure. Or instead of this, the other alternative is, yes, so this is RB. We will retain this, and we will introduce a hinge at the point A, destroy the moment carrying capacity. We'll introduce another hinge in the structure, Therefore, you are removing the moment carrying capacity at A and also the moment carrying capacity at B. So, this is coordinate 1. Coordinate 1 is a moment, or the corresponding displacement is a rotation. So, you may be interested. So, we will be applying moment here, or let us mark only the coordinate first. Yes, this is the coordinate 2. So your redundants are MA and MB. Your MA and MB are the redundants. So here also, same procedure. Find out the displacement first due to the external forces, for which we will make use of the conjugate beam method. We will draw the conjugate beam. Find out the shear force here. So that will be the slope at the corresponding section. All those things we will discuss later. It's only introduction. So if you just find out the value of U1 and U2 due to the external forces by using conjugate beam method. Right. Then apply so you can treat this as two simply supported beams. Once if you introduce hinges, you can treat this as two simply supported beams. So apply the redundant 1 equal to unity, get the value of the first column of the flexibility matrix. Then you apply F2 alone, the redundant force at B equal to unity, get the second column of the matrix. So how to get these values, we will discuss later, and then find out the redundants. So that is the definition for primary structure. So the redundants, whether they are reactions as discussed before or whether they are moments as discussed now, we will be fixing. And of course, you will have to follow one sign convention here that we will discuss when we take up the problem. And once you find out the redundants, we can draw the support moment diagram, on which when you superimpose the simplest support moment diagram, we will get the bending moment diagram. Sign convention we will discuss later. Now, I think that is about the overall idea about the flexibility matrix method. So mainly you have to deal with the matrix, the flexibility matrix A into F equal to minus U. This is a general formula, this is a general compatibility equation. So what I want you to know is, what is A, what is U, these are the redundants. And you have to be very confident that A and U, they are all consisting of only displacements. We can use any classical methods. That is enough. That's about the And final things, how to analyze a continuous beam, how to analyze a portal frame, how to analyze a truss, all those things we'll discuss later. Depending upon the problem, statically determined problem, the number of coordinates will decide the size of the flexibility matrix. Indeterminate structures, the degree of static indeterminacy will decide the size of the flexibility matrix. We can just go on discussing, somewhere we have to stop. This only an overview of the methods, the different terms like coordinates, etc., different terms and the meaning of different terms. I think that will be enough for introduction part. Later we will be dealing with the analysis of continuous beams, portal frames and roof trusses, etc. And that completes this lecture. Thank you for patience.